Hello and welcome to another Overlord lore video, and today we will take a look at the four Imperial Knights of the Empire of Baharuth. The Emperor's finest warriors, personal guards, representatives and commanders. But before we dive into the lore, I want to thank my Patreons for supporting this channel. Now, what are the four Imperial Knights exactly? They are the absolute elite unit of the Empire, solely selected for their battle capabilities. And since Jircnivs only wants the absolute best available warriors to work for him, essentially anybody can join the highest of elite units if he or she has the skill to back it up, regardless if the person is a commoner like Basywood Pashmel, or indeed has more of a mercenary approach to all of it, like Linus, who had explicitly stated that she would prioritize her own life over everything else. To Jircnivs, merit is the only thing that matters. Of course, there are limits. If one has the byname of Mad Emperor Slayer, I highly doubt that he would be allowed anywhere near Jircnivs. But in general, this Emperor is surprisingly lenient in regards of the loyalty of his Pretorian Guard. Still, even with this casual approach towards loyalty in mind, they are more akin to the Kingsguard from Game of Thrones, while the warrior troop of Rhys Tys resembles more or less the Servicor from Attack on Titans. This in part is due to the fact that even if King Ramposa, Princess Rena, or her pet would die, Lachius could just be paid to resurrect them, and while their life force would be much diminished, they would still be alive and able to regain their former strength. But in case of Jircnivs, emperors die when they are killed. While still a member of the Adventurer Guild, Lachius repeatedly breached guild conduct in order to combat the Eight Fingers, and even the nobles allied with them, despite explicit rule against it, wouldn't likely even consider to resurrect Jircnivs, even if such a request would be issued. And while the Theocracy actually might be willing to help him, let's just say that a bunch of zealots aren't necessarily the most rational of counterparties. And with downfall of castle and country in mind, it would be unwise to rely on a miracle from the six great gods. Therefore, the four Imperial Knights are acting as bodyguards. But as mentioned before, this is far from the only thing they are doing. They are also trusted advisors and representatives. For example, each of them holds the rank of general, when attached to, or rather, in charge of one of the eight Imperial Legions, and to ensure that Jircnivs' commands are always carried out, and that the Emperor stays in control of Arvintar, the capital of Baharuth. There's the rule that at least one of the four Imperial Knights has to be present at the capital at all times. Now, as Imperial Knights, they are also given not only a handsome amount of payment, but also top-tier equipment. Their gear allows them to be faster, stronger, more resistant, and overall better. And while the information here is directly taken from the Overlord Wiki, and only applies towards the web novel, I wanted to focus your attention not so much on what you are reading, but at what isn't said. Sure, the Imperial Knights have access to healing spells and lots of potions, but they aren't self-healing. They are not immune to insta-death magic. They do not have infinite stamina, or access to a blade that could damage Ein Solgaun and potentially even his world item, like Gazef's Throne of Doss. What I wanted to say is that while the four Imperial Knights are extremely strong and extremely well equipped, they aren't as strong as the warrior captain of the kingdom, and they know this. Furthermore, Gazef killed two of them during one of the many annual wars of the Empire, and together with his warrior troop he turned the tide of the entire battle, preventing an Imperial victory. Simply speaking, if the four Imperial Knights could carve through the kingdom's army like a knife through a cake, then Gazef Stronov would be able to cut through the Iron Knife, like Zoro did in One Piece in his battle with Mr. Zero. By the way, this came out like 2 decades ago. Oh boy, I'm getting old. Could you imagine if Overlord had the same amount of runtime as One Piece? It would be an absolute treat. Anyway, moving on. In order to illustrate why Gazef Stronov was able to beat two of the Imperial Knights and turn the tide of an entire war, I will use another odd comparison, this time from Warhammer Total War. Imagine Gazef Stronov and his warrior troop as Vlad von Karstein, accompanied by a unit of Blood Knights, fighting against two Imperial generals. While Vlad devours one of them in melee combat, regenerating himself during the entire fight, the Blood Knights are keeping the other general busy and inflicting damage and draining his stamina. After the first general dies, Vlad and the Blood Knights utterly destroy the other, thus routing the entire army of the Empire due to a loss of two commanders and the potential fight with a self-regenerating, perpetual death machine. What I wanted to illustrate is that while the four Imperial Knights are extremely strong, they are weaker than Garzev, and their equipment is also no match for the five treasures of the kingdom. Sure, they have healing spells, buffs and potions, but they aren't a tireless regenerating perpetual death machine like Garzev is with the treasures equipped. And once two of Emperor Jircnivs' elite warrior generals were dead, the rest of the Imperial legions retreated to avoid further casualties. But while the loss of half of Jircnivs' absolute elite warrior unit is a tragedy, the victory of the kingdom was pyrrhic at best. After suffering grievous losses already, the kingdom didn't so much won the engagement, as it had made sure that it could survive the annual wars at least another 12 months. And thanks to the superior logistic, management and military apparatus of the Empire, the two lost Imperial Knights could be replaced rather quickly. So other than against the warrior captain of the kingdom, Brain Anglaus or possibly Blue Roses, there are no unfavorable matchups when fighting against the Empire's enemies. Of course, the strongest Imperial Knight died during one of Mare's earthquakes, but this wasn't a matchup for the same reason that the fight, Lion vs. Steak, isn't considered a fight at all, but is simply called dinner. Now, while we are discussing battlefield topics, let me just illustrate why the four Imperial Knights are the equivalent of a general in rank. Jircniv, especially at the beginning of his reign, was heavily reliant on the Imperial army to stay in power, while purging the nobility of the Empire and reorganizing the state. A lot of the old elite was either executed or at the very least fired and replaced with upstart commoners that actually know what they are doing. So while Jircniv is feared, he's also despised among many noble houses. And therefore, and since his father was poisoned by his enemies, it is incredibly vital for Jircniv to maintain control over the Imperial legions, as his hammer to bring down on his enemies, and as a reassurance that his friends will stay friendly. Now, while the four Imperial Knights are recruited solely for talent, and aren't among the most loyal of Jircniv's servants, the politically savvy Emperor knows whom to trust with what information and tasks, and who better to remove from critical info and his guard. Looking in your direction, Linus. So for example, Jircniv might suspect that one of his legion's general is about to rebel in favor of a noble house that wants to see the Emperor dead, or at least replaced, and his reforms undone. But thanks to his Imperial Knights, he only needs to send Basywood Peshmel in order to demote the general and remove him from the command. Since both General and Imperial Knight are of the same rank, all Peshmel now needs to do is to show off the order from Emperor Jircniv himself to the soldiers of the Legion, in order to turn the entire Legion against the supposedly disloyal General. And once the Legion is behind the Knight, he could deal with the General in any fashion his Emperor ordered. And if the General would refuse to step down, then Peshmel would be more than able to kill him on the spot. Now you might ask yourself, why would Jircniv send specifically Peshmel in order to remove him from power? Well, because Peshmel is a commoner, or rather was a commoner, who earned his place among the four knights. So any return of the nobility would be akin to a death sentence for him, and therefore he could be relied on at the circumstance to carry out the Emperor's will without fault. While other knights might be more open to bribery. In essence, while Jircniv is willing to overlook somewhat unsteady or in case of Linus, even a pragmatic approach towards loyalty among his most elite unit in order to get the best possible fighters, he in return can rely on his own political cunning in order to stay in control of all of them. So in terms of military structure, the four Imperial Knights act as a second and final layer of command, ready to take over if a general dies or deserts in order to prevent any change in loyalty of the Imperial Legion, which also implies that the four Imperial Knights are, while not exclusive to him, still requiring the political cunning of Emperor Jircnivs in order to be wielded properly and to their fullest potential. And if the loyalty of the Imperial Knights is somewhat unsteady, they also can't trust each other and therefore are very, very unlikely to ever conspire against the Emperor in order to take power for themselves. And next time we will take a look at the individual members, because there's quite a bit of interesting lore behind each of them. But for now I say thank you very much for watching, and, as usual, special thanks to Adam J, Al Capone, Andy, Angel of Death, Batguy Yee, Boyzilla, Chrissy, Diabetic Centaur, Dystopia, Elika Birchleaf, Phaelis Katus, Feral Shivorn, Gigafight, Ghost of Epicness, Hector Marino, Black Phoenix Emperor, Hoss, Jason, Kleinator, Chromius, Large, Lord Nishikien Rai, Lord Touch Me, Lord Ulbert Elaine Odell, Lucas Oli, Lexus Fox, Majima, Matt C, Marcos, Mr. Schuss, Mindless Rev, Minu 13, Mirtis, Nferia's Potion, Primus 11, Sasuga Einsamer, Sebastian, Shadow Lightning Wolf, Search, Sparkly Unicorn, The Orc Warboss, Rock Edsmashar, Vash Hawkeye, Zogo Bane of a Lot, and Zonagon. Thanks, guys. Anyway, have a nice day, over and out.